Hello all, welcome to Developing Success, and this lecture is about the 100 most important topics for the prelims 2020, which is going to be held on 4th of October 2020, and this is part 1 of our series. And I am here to make your work easy so that you can just see these videos and you complete the important topics, and I am sure you will be finding some questions from these lectures, as I have tried to cover all the aspects from the current affairs and also from the traditional point of view. And I have also tried to cover all the important government schemes which were in news, all the places, the map pointings, about the national parks, about science and technology, about history, about art and culture, geography and everything. So this is the part one of the lecture, and I will be coming up with some 10 parts, and if I think that it is required more, we can do more parts of the series 100 most important topics for the UPSC prelims 2020. So we start with the lecture. Now the first thing is that Maharaja Duleep Singh was in news continuously in year 2019 because some Congress MPs were demanding that his belongings should be brought back to India. So from that we get to know that belongings of Maharaja Duleep Singh is not in India, and all his remains are in the Great Britain. So first of all, Maharaja Duleep Singh becomes important. So we will study it from here, that he was the last ruler of the Sikh Empire, and he was born to Maharaja Ranjit Singh in 1838 in Lahore. And as we know that Maharaja Ranjit Singh had many wives, so this last wife, Jind Kaur, so from Jind Kaur this Maharaja Duleep Singh was born, and this small Maharaja was declared the Maharaja of Punjab in 1843 after the death of Ranjit Singh, and he was only the age of 5. And in 1849, after the Second Anglo-Sikh War, Singh was forced to give up claims of sovereignty in exchange of a pension of 40,000 pounds a year. And he was 10 years old that time. So significantly, in 1849, after the British defeated the Sikhs in the war, Singh was forced to sign a legal document that amended the Treaty of Lahore, requiring him to not only give up the claims of sovereignty of the region, but also the Kohinoor diamond. So this is an important part. This can be asked that by which of the following kings or by which of the following empires did our Kohinoor diamond went upon to the British. So the answer will be Maharaja Duleep Singh. So the diamond eventually made its way to England, and the diamond is now the part of British crown jewels kept in the Tower of London. And this Maharaja Duleep Singh was the only Sikh ruler who was converted to Christianity and settled in UK. Okay, and let me tell you that why are Maharaja Duleep Singh's remains in England, because in 1864 Singh married Bamba Muller in Cairo in Egypt, and then he moved to Elvedon in England. Queen Victoria became the godmother of their eldest son, who was named Victor Duleep Singh. So Victor Duleep Singh was the eldest son of Maharaja Duleep Singh, and Queen Victoria was the godmother for him, and she named her because after her Prince Albert Victor. In 1886, he is said to have tried to return to India. So Maharaja Duleep Singh tried to return to India, and he wanted to meet his mother who was in exile in Kathmandu, and he also wanted to reconvert himself into Sikhism. But when he was coming to India to reconvert himself into Sikhism, he was caught by the British in the Aden in Yemen. So this is a Arabian Peninsula country, Yemen, and here he was caught, and he was not allowed to go to India to convert himself into Sikhism, but he converted in a very small ceremony itself in the Aden in the Yemen, and then he went to Paris. So till death he remained in Paris, and he died in Paris only, and his body was brought to England where he was buried. So his remains are in England, and Congress MPs want his remains to be back to India because he was the last ruler of the Sikh Empire. So this was all about this news. So you must know about Duleep Singh so that you can answer any question which is asked in regard to him. Our next topic is in regard to the Himalayan gold. Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary and Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve. So this Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary have been in news for at least 3 times. First, it was in news in October 2019 because there were new types of butterflies were seen, which shifted actually from a lower latitude, from a lower altitude. And Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary is located at a higher altitude, so it was a new thing for this sanctuary. Second, this Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary was a part of the snow leopard survey, which was done for the first time. So snow leopard survey in India was done for the first time, and Ascot was a part of that. Third, it was reported in a Down to Earth magazine about the Himalayan gold, which is a type of, you can say, like cannabis, like drug. So it is called the Himalayan Viagra, and it is used for the medicine purpose also. So a illegal trade has been started in the Himalayas in the upper altitude, like the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve, like the Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve, like the Dihang Dibang Biosphere Reserve in Arunachal Pradesh. So that is why this whole thing was in news. Now there is a caterpillar fungus, that it is a fungal parasite, and that belongs to the ghost moth. In recent times, the species has been widely traded as an aphrodisiac and a powerful tonic, often called as Himalayan Viagra. And there are also reports that caterpillar fungus possesses a range of more specific therapeutic properties. That is, it can work against asthma, it can work against bronchial inflammation, it can cure renal complications, and it can also stimulate our immune system. So that is why it was in news. As you can see, it is mainly found in the Tibetan plateau, as you can see in the map. So this is the region where this Himalayan gold rush is found. And if we talk about India, you can find it in Uttarakhand and in some parts of Sikkim and in some parts of Arunachal, which are bordering the Tibet part of China. Okay, so that is why. And this species is actually endemic to the Tibetan plateau and also the adjoining Himalayas, and it is found mainly above the sea level of 3200 to 4500 meters. And in the Indian Himalayas, it is mainly found in the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve, Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary, Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve, and Dihang Dibang Biosphere Reserve. Guys, for the Biosphere Reserve lecture, I have made a separate lecture. I have given the link in the description box. You can check it out from there. You can watch the whole lecture. There I have described all the 18 Biosphere Reserves in India with the MAP program. Now we move forward. And a butterfly also was in news because of this area. So the name of the butterfly is Himalayan tailless bush blue, and it was known to occur at an altitude between 1300 to 24 only in Jammu Kashmir and Uttarakhand. But recently it was located above 3500 meter, that is in the Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary, and that is 1200 meter higher than its known range. Because of the climate change, because of the shifting pattern of the rainfall, of the snowfall, these species are also migrating upward. Okay, so that is why Ascot becomes important. And Ascot is also important because this area is known as your Pithoragarh districts in Uttarakhand, the area which I am encircling. And this area is the Kalapani. So Kalapani falls within this sanctuary only, and the Kalapani is in news because of the Indo-Nepal and Indo-China relations all this year in 2019 and 20. That is why this area states important because of the map pointing and all. And this is the area of the Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary also. Now let me tell you that the Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary is in the Kumaon Himalayas. You can note down it. It is in the Kumaon Himalayas, and the district is Pithoragarh district, the same district where the Kalapani is located. And the primary objective of this Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary was to conserve musk deer. So this is the primary objective. Now in the wildlife sanctuary of Ascot, the Lipu Lake Pass falls. You have studied about Lipu Lake Pass in Indo-Nepal relations. The Lumpia Dhura or the Lumpia Lake, from where the Kuthiyangti River is coming out, and the Kalapani. These three are the important places which are in news, and all these places are the part of the Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary. The rivers which are associated with the Ascot Wildlife Sanctuary are the Gori Ganga, Ikli, and also Dhauli. Let me tell you, it is not Dhauli Ganga which is joining the Alaknanda. It is separate river, Dhauli. Okay. Now we move on to the third topic, which is the trans fat. Okay, why are we studying it? Because trans fat free logo was launched by the Union Health Minister, and trans fat is not good for health, and that is why trans fat free logo was launched, and that is why we are studying about it. So there are two types of trans fat. The first is natural and next is artificial. The natural trans fat is found in the dairy products, in the meat products of the cattle, sheep and goats, but the artificial trans fat, they are the industrial trans fat, partially hydrogenated and are hazardous to health. So these fats also occur when vegetable oils are chemically altered to stay solid at room temperature. So this is their property. They are chemically altered to be staying solid at room temperature, which gives them a much longer shelf life. So people who consume more of these unnatural and artificial trans fat, they actually have significant increase in bad cholesterol, and they have a rise, they have a fall in the good cholesterol. So which gives you two risk, two very bad risk, that is the weight gain and diabetes, which will in future invite heart attack or heart diseases. Okay, so this is a very important thing, that is why the health ministry launched. So the objective was to make India free from trans fat by 2022, and this has been assigned to the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, FSSAI, and the logo has been launched to give the movement upright support, that is the Eat Right movement of India. India targets to eliminate trans fat by 2022. So WHO has targeted this same thing, but the year is 2023. So India, as said by our Prime Minister, will target this a year before. So this was in news, that is why we are studying it. And let me tell you that this trans fat is also known as unsaturated fat, and there is a natural kind of trans fat is also the breast milk of a woman. Okay, so remember this, in a breast milk you will be finding vaccinic acid, that is also a kind of trans fat, but that is good for health because that is a natural trans fat. So whenever the things get unnatural, it will be not helpful in our health. So it is a byproduct of the vegetable and the fish industry, which is also not good. So Outlook India 2020 said that trans fat is the reason for heart diseases in most of the cases. Next, we are studying about the global competitiveness index. So why are we studying it? Because it was thoroughly in news as India slipped down 10 positions in this ranking. So that is why we are studying about it. So the Global Competitiveness Index was first launched in 1979 by the World Economic Forum. Let me tell you, this particular information was asked in 2019 prelims paper, and the question was very simple, that which of the following gives us the Global Competitiveness Index every year, and the answer was World Economic Forum. But let me tell you, there was another question also in 2019 which was asking about the indicators which this index takes into account to give the ranking, and that was asked about the world of ease of doing business. So that is why this particular topic becomes important in regard to the indicators. So in the 2019 index, India at 68th position among 141 countries. So 10 ranks below the 2018 position. In 2018, it was in the 58th position. Now it is in 68. So see, the rank has been decreased by 10 number. But the decrease in the actual progress is not that much significant. I will tell you how. See, in this 141 countries of the world, 99% of the world GDP is accounted by this 141 countries. And this global competitiveness index, it counts on total factor productivity. So what is total factor productivity? It is just the efficiency with which different factors of production works. So in our economy, we read that the factors of production are land, labor and capital. So how this land, labor and capital are utilized in a particular country gives us the indicator about the total factor productivity, and then the global competitiveness index is framed. So four things you need to keep in mind, That is, these four categories are studied when they give you the ranking. That is enabling environment, human capital, markets and innovation ecosystem. ठीक है, दीज फोर विल बी द कैटेगरीज. नाउ हाउ दे गिव यू द स्कोर, दे गिव यू ऑन 0 to 100 स्केल. इन 0 to 100 स्केल द ओवरऑल स्कोर ऑफ इंडिया इज 61.4. सो ओनली 0.7 इज द डिक्रीज, बट द रैंक हैज़ बीन डिक्रीज अप टू द 10 points. वाई? बिकॉज अदर कंट्रीज हैव परफॉर्म्ड वेरी वेल इन कंपेयर टू इंडिया. फॉर एग्जाम्पल कैम्बोडिया, फॉर एग्जाम्पल अर्जेंटाइना, फॉर एग्जाम्पल श्रीलंका. These countries have performed really well, and this time Singapore has got rank 1 and it has pushed US to the second place. Hong Kong ranked 3rd, Netherlands 4th and Switzerland is 5th. Now I will discuss you the 2019 question. See, which of the following is not a sub-index of the World Bank's ease of doing business? So here they have not asked you that which of the following organizations is giving this index. They have asked you the indicators. So that is why we studied the indicators of the Global Competitiveness Index also. So if when we talk about business, so business is related to taxes, business is related to property, business is related to construction permit. So what is not indicated is answer is A, maintenance of law and order. So if you don't know the answer also, by simple logic also you can solve these types of questions. Now we move on to another topic, that is the Mosaic Arctic Expedition. So the full form is the Multidisciplinary Drifting Observatory for the Study of Arctic Climate. First of all, why are they studying the Arctic climate? Because the Arctic ice is melting too much. And when the ice is becoming thin, the sunlight is penetrating deeper down and it is melting the ice further, which will invite flooding and which will invite erratic rainfall, erratic season, extreme climate. So a kind of climate change is happening in an aggravating manner. And that is why this expedition has been launched in the Arctic, to study about how the Arctic is actually influencing our atmosphere, so that a proper planning and proper precautionary measure can be taken by the World Forum, and we can live a healthy in a healthy environment. So we will be knowing about this. Is that if you can see the map from the Tromso, the expedition started, and this Tromso is actually present in the Norwegian coast, and it will go in the central Arctic ocean. Okay, so only one Indian is there in their whole program, and the thing will be starting from the German institute, Alfred Wegener Institute. They have actually given this vehicle, German research vehicle, which has been named as Polar Strun. This particular vehicle has been used previously also for the expeditions in Antarctica and Arctic, but this expedition is very special because it is one year long, which has not happened before. And other countries like USA and Russia, they have also put money into this expedition, and this will mainly provide us with the scientific basis for the development of policies of a sustainable development of the Arctic, and also support with the decision making facts in the areas of mitigation and adaptation to combat the climate change. So from India, Vishnu Nandan has gone into this expedition. And Arctic is a very key area, as we all know, when we study about the global climate change, with warming rates exceeding twice the global average. So that is why you need to know about this whole Mosaic thing. Now we move on to another topic, that is the Rangdo Monastery. Why are we studying this? Because recently Government of India said that Rangdo Monastery will be made a monument of importance, a monument of national importance, and it will be given a ASI monument status so that it can be preserved further. It was actually built 200 years ago in 18th century. And who built it? It was built by the Gelek Yash Takpa, who was and the king then was the Sewang Mangyul. So this can be asked in prelims. Apart from this, it is a Tibetan Buddhist monastery, Gelugpa sect, and Suru Valley. It is in the Suru Valley. Suru is actually the tributary of River Indus. Okay, Suru is the tributary of river Indus. That is why I remember it. And it is very, this site is very near to the Pensila mountain pass. This site was electrified by the solar energy by Global Himalayan Expedition in 2017 recently. And the site is important as it is also known because of its money walls. So what is this money walls? Is the walls engraved with precious stones. Okay, so this is one of the architectural importance of this Rangdum monastery. So remember all this information that will fetch marks in your prelims and can also fetch marks in mains examination while you quote some kind of example, some kind of achievement or our policy in regard to ASI and cultural importance in India and all that. Next we move on to our last topic, and that is India-China informal summit, which was held in Mahabalipuram near the Chennai coast, which is also known as Mamallapuram. So the actual name of this place is Mamallapuram only, but with the coming on the British and their pronunciation, this Mamallapuram of late became Mahabalipuram. So in 2020, India-China relations will be 70 years old, and to mark this informal summit in Wuhan in 2018 and then in 2019 in Mamallapuram was held. But as we can see that in 2020, when the India and China are completing 70 years of international partnership and international relation, it is not all good between both the countries, as we can see that there are still the border disputes. So when they met in Wuhan in 2018, they talked about the 2005 agreement of the LAC, they talked about good partnership, they talked about terrorism, everything. But to 2020, as I see, is not going good for India and China relations, which is marking their 70th anniversary. So also 2020, they said, will be designated as a year of India-China culture and people-to-people exchanges, of which very opposite is happening, and we hope everything is fine between both the countries as these two are the big Asian powers. So the first summit was the first informal summit was held in Wuhan, and the summit was mainly focused on Wuhan spirit strategy, and the second summit was Mahabalipuram, and the name given, the strategy name given, was Chennai Connect. So Wuhan summit will be factors for stability in the current international landscape, which did not actually happen. So Wuhan summit, when they met in Wuhan in 2018, they talked about the Panchsheel policy also, and they talked about three basic things. So these three basic thing was the backbone, becoming backbone of each other in the economic globalization, and they also talked about cooperation of joint projects in Afghanistan, which has always remained an area of contraction between the two countries. And the third thing they talked about, that India refused to join OBOR, and that will not come in way of any of the economic cooperation. This was all talked about in Wuhan. So when they met in the Mahabalipuram summit, considering the age-old commercial as well as maritime linkages, both the countries agreed to establish sister state relation between Tamil Nadu and Fujian province. So Tamil Nadu and Fujian province was related because Fujian recently engraved and find out relations with Tamil Nadu in terms of architecture, which I will describe further in this lecture. So 10 big things were that high level economic partnership they talked about. They talked about the Chinese investments in India. They talked about manufacturing hubs. They talked about the Fujian sister state connection. They talked about the academy proposed to study links between Fujian and Mamallapuram. They talked about the India-China cultural relation in 2020. And they also talked about other activities. But none of them is working right now, because right now India has broken apart the deal of RCEP. To watch that RCEP lecture, I have again given the link in the description box, you can see. And apart from pulling out from the RCEP, India is already not there in the OBOR. And then again, because of the closeness to US and a cold trade war between US and China, India is again on the lines of China in an against manner. So that is all not feasible at this moment. So for this lecture, we will study about Mamallapuram. So it is an important town because it was a Pallava settlement. Pallava dynasty ruled here in South India, and the Pallava dynasty ruled in South India from 3rd century to 9th century. Okay, and the city of Mamallapuram was founded by the Pallava king Narasimha Varman I in the 7th century. It was during Narasimha Varman I's reign that Hiwensang, the Chinese Buddhist monk traveler, visited Pallava capital of Kanchipuram. Okay, so Bodhidharma, one of the famous Buddhist monk in China, is believed to be the third son of this Pallava king, Narasimha Varman I, who traveled from Kanchipuram through Mamallapuram to China in 527 AD. And Mamallapuram and the Pallava dynasty are also historically relevant for the earliest records security pact between China and India in the 8th century that involved Pallava king Rajasimhan Narasimha Varman II, from whom the Chinese sought help to counter Tibet. Okay, so if you talk about the Tamil Nadu part, so in Tamil Nadu, the Mamallapuram is just on the coast and it is very near, and you can see the Mamallapuram. If you can see, this is Pondicherry, this is Chennai, and here is your Mamallapuram. Okay, so this is your Mamallapuram, this is your Kanchipuram. As you can see, it's very near to the Chennai coast, and the area is very important in regard to the architectural importance. So if you want to know about the Fujian province, this is the map of China, and Fujian is here. So Fujian is just on the coast, and the opposite coast is located Taiwan. And if you want to know about Fujian, so I will tell you about Fujian also. First, let me tell you that there have been a major trading connections between Pallava and Chola kingdoms of South India with the southeastern coast of China, particularly the province of Fujian and the city of Quanzhou. So China's Song dynasty had maintained diplomatic ties with Chola kingdom. It is interesting to know that President Xi Jinping has been the governor of the same Fujian province from 1999 to 2002. Tamil inscriptions and fragments of architecture reflecting a possible temple built by Tamil traders in 12th century have been recently discovered in Quanzhou in the Fujian province, and that is why this Chennai Connect was built into this informal summit. Now I want to tell you some things about Mahabalipuram or Mamallapuram. So Mamallapuram is a World Heritage Site, and this World Heritage Site tag was given in the year 1984. And why it was given? Because it has cave temples. Apart from the cave temples, it has shore temple. It is important for your examination. And then you have Pancharatha temple. Pancharatha temple, and you also have Ola Kaneshwara temple. So all these temples are important, as these are the open air rock sculptures, which is important for your art and culture. Open air rock sculptures. And if we talk about the cave temples, we have cave temples like Trimurti caves, and you have cave temples like Krishna cave, Adi Braha caves. If you talk about shore temple is just present on the beach, and it has a gopuram. So what is a gopuram? It is nothing but gateway. So the gateway is called the gopuram. Again, it has a shikhara. So what is shikhara? Shikhara is nothing but roof. So if they ask in examination Pallava architecture of gopuram and shikhara, it is related to the shore temple in Mahabalipuram. And then we have Pancharatha temple. This is based on the Mahabharata depiction. Pancharatha is related to the Arjun and Yudhishthir and Nakul. Okay, and then we have Ola Kaneshwar temple. This temple is dedicated to Lord Shiva. Okay, so this was all about the thing about Wuhan spirit and Mamallapuram and Fujian connection. So this is all about this lecture. I will meet you in part 2 of our series 100 most important topics, and I am very confident and sure that you will surely receive some of the questions from these lectures, and this is a very good way to revise your current affairs also with the traditional aspect, as I am describing all the traditional things and related things with this. So stay tuned, study well, do your optional well in this time, and write answers, keep asking questions, stay tuned and be active. Thank you.